word artist or art gets thrown around a lot anymore. Everybody's a freaking artist, man. If you make YouTube videos, you're an artist. It's pretty rare for me in my mind to think of something as art. I understand that art doesn't have to be like a picture or a drawing or a painting, but to me, if I had to define art, it would be you make something with your hands that other people, doesn't have to be everybody, but some people think is beautiful. If you do that consistently, I think you're an artist. Or if you do that to the masses, I think you're an artist. I think one job in the hunting industry, or whatever you want to call this space that I live in, that I think could be classified as an artist is the traditional bowyers. And I'm going to go visit one of those today. I'm going up to Peru, Indiana, which is the hometown of Bushman Bows. I'm excited to go and check out what Steven has up here and see how he makes his Bushman bows. It's gonna be awesome. Made it. One thing I don't miss about northern Indiana is the wind.
Well, I'm Steve Jouett, bowyer and master of operations here of Bushman Bows.
Floor sweeper as well.
Yeah, floor sweeper, mail guy, telephone answer, and I say bad words when I make mistakes.
There you go.
Which I repent from every day.
Look at that thing.
This has just been sanded out. And this is my proprietary takedown system. This is this bow looks gorgeous when it's clear coated.
Oh, I can imagine.
Yeah, that just pops.
That's like the final step before you finish it and everything.
Yeah.
So now, it's tillered out.
This isn't
ready to go.
Done. This isn't complete, which gets my proprietary grip, and I'll show you what that looks like. This has all been block sanded out. Now it'll get some airbrush work done. I'll do the camo on the front, and then I'll build the strings for it, and that's how it works. But this is the takedown system. So this is like flawless.
Yeah, it fits perfect.
Yeah, and it's easy to come out. But the thing is with that locking device I come up with, there's no movement in this at all.
The groove gives it a little extra.
Yeah. Plus, I have a magnetic system in it as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Very unique. They're super unique. That's what caught my eye the first time I saw them. I was like, wow, look at that. That's not, you know, I haven't seen something like that before.
Oh, thank you. I have so many options, I can't even remember them all.
Yeah.
You know, it'd be like, I forgot about that one. I have a lot of scaling profile. My new tip design, that's what all my tips are going to look like now. And that, of course, brightens
yeah,
up.
Yeah, yeah.
So this grip kind of locks in. It's kind of a pistol-style grip.
Yep.
But it's rounded for you to, if you want to shoot like this, that's fine. If you want to shoot like this, that's fine. But it gives you, it's got a little swell here. It just lays right in real nice. You're not going to be doing this, or, you know, you're not going to search. Unless you're a real, you know, you like a really high wrist.
Right.
So this is what being custom's about. I have a lot of guys that like the handles that go wah.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that. I don't care. I mean, if you don't like the handle on your bow, you're going to sell it.
Oh, yeah. I think it's one of the biggest factors.
Probably, in my eyes, of being a bowyer, it's probably the most important thing. So I'm very, very particular about it. I spend a lot of time on handles, and these are all manufactured from composite. So if 2 weeks go down the road and you guys got a new bow from me, you say, man, that handle, you know, I like it, but it just needs to be a little bit, well, I'll fix it for them. So what they do is they send the bow back to me, and I'll redo the whole thing. And they won't know.
Yeah.
In other words, it'll just be different. It'll look brand new. I am so busy.
Yeah.
The problem is my bows take so long to make now.
Yeah.
I mean, here's my routine. I make 6 bows on my molds, and then I got to scale everything out, make sure I made weight. Then I start building according to order. And I start and I work on six bows at a time. And it takes me 2 months to get those six bows done. That's not a lot of bows. You know?
Yeah, no.
I just can't build them any faster.
Yeah.
I mean, this stuff here, this is all hand done.
Yeah.
I mean, this section in here takes me over 6 hours to do.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's all done by hand. So, you know, I'm like, dude, you know, this is ridiculous. But you know what? That's pretty unique. And I know it.
Right.
And I'm proud of it. So, in stuff like this, this is all laid up. I just don't glue my stuff down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you have, stuff will let go.
Oh, yeah.
Everything is formed. And then it's glued down. So that's a more extensive process.
Right.
So I have my own skills that I use, and it goes back to working in a cabinet shop.
Is that where you got your start with woodworking?
Well, yeah, kind of, sort of. My dad was a carpenter. I've been around it since I was a baby. But my skills really began as a finisher.
Mm.
And I could say by the time I was 25, I was a master finisher. I could finish pianos.
Oh, awesome.
Which I did. Guitars, automobiles, but a lot of cabinets, a lot of furniture. I ran a furniture service for years. And that working in a cabinet shop, you learn how to laminate. You learn how to laminate stuff, glue, jigs, machinery. So all that stuff, even though I wasn't using it all the time, I'm working with a crew that is.
Yeah.
And I'm always going, man, how do you do that? Oh, it's simple. You just do this. And all that stuff sinks in your head after a while. So form building and just all that stuff you learn. But the finishing end of it, the artistic part, in all mediums, that was the experience that really got me into making really fine, mm-hmm. world-class bows. You know, when I started doing this, and it's kind of funny, I still have the first bow I ever built, but, you know, I was like, I'm going to build the best bow in the world.
Yeah.
You know, and that's my attitude. And I always have that. When I stop feeling that way, I'm not going to build bows anymore. And what it is you just, it's like what the guy at the, I think the Push talks about, where you just lose your concentration. Mm-hmm.
Joel Turner.
You're going into the shot failing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something, and now how I got rid of it is I just said, well, from now on, I don't care about killing a deer. I'm going to take the shot if it feels good.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to freak out if I don't see anything or if I don't fill my tag.
Right.
Now, I understand about it because I used to I'd throw my bow out of a tree when I missed, and
yeah.
You know, I'd be screaming. People could hear me blocks away. That's just stupid.
Show me your that unique tip with the hook, like for the hanging your bow on a limb. I thought that was pretty neat.
Oh, that's my talon. In fact, that I just shipped out one that had some really nice talons on it. This is a...
There's one, yeah. That's a good looking bow.
This is going to China.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yep. There's no finish on this bow at all. It hasn't really been. I'm just about ready. I just got the handle done on it. I mean, feel the handle on it.
Oh, wow. Just that is comfortable.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
And this handle is.
I like how narrow it is up here, honestly.
Yeah. And I don't. Look, I can only go so far. I have a safety factor here. So once I hit that safety factor, I know that's it. I can't grind anymore. That's something I established. A lot of guys do it too. But this handles what I call a pistol thumb.
Mm-hmm.
It's got some swell on it. And I also do, this is... my new style knock as well. As you can only see it right there. See, it's got mm-hmm. a different profile.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Now I'm going to do all my knocks like that. I just came up with that because, and I call it a tacti knock. This is my tacti knock. So I can, string this bow either on the outside or on the inside. If I string it on the inside, it gains me about 3 pounds.
Okay.
Or I can change the tiller a little bit.
Yeah.
I can go on the inside of this nock and the outside of this nock, which is going to make the limb more positive, more not as stiff.
Yeah, that's true. So if, like, if you're going to run a crawl or something, you could.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Now, you have the opportunity. The bow has to be strung either negative or even, three under or split.
Right.
When it's ordered, but you can manipulate that a little bit. And some bows will get more of a reaction out of it. Like, especially if I do 1-inch increments.
Mm-hmm.
So this nock right here, the third one is for stringing. So I'll show you what that is.
I like that camo pattern you put on that bow too.
Yeah, that's my ghost camo.
Let me show people on the.
And there,
yeah,
is,
that's cool.
There is green in that, but I do a lot of that. So this is just the standard looped stringer, and that goes in there like that. You can string this the other way, but I got injured stringing a bow one time, and I learned my lesson. So that's how quick it is.
That's cool.
Yeah. So I can manipulate various. Of course, if you're going to manipulate your string, you have to tighten it. Sometimes you have to, because watch.
Yeah, see, and you may change your tune too, or will.
Oh no, you will.
Yeah.
So. But it gives you versatility, and it's a better selling factor as well, because if the bow is not quite what the person wants, he might be able to get what he wants out of it through the increments. That's pretty low. But you can see that that's negative on the top. It's a little stiffer on this.
Yeah, I can tell.
So
I can tell.
You want that for a 3-under shooter.
Yeah.
Because he's pulling more on the bottom limb.
More pressure on the bottom limb.
Yeah, which is the timing. It's like a compound bow. Your limbs get out of time. That's why you'll see guys shooting a crawl with an even tiller bow, or and you'll hear just a blang.
Yeah.
It just makes a
it
huge
feels
noise.
Horrible too. When the...
And you know, that doesn't bother some people, but I don't like it.
Me either.
This is my 52-inch American Native.
Oh dang!
Tactical series. So this bow here, of course, it's still stuck together from the paint. There we go. I mean, you can put that in your back pocket. It's so small.
Yeah, that'd be easy to take on a plane.
Yeah. So this comes apart really super easy.
Mm-hmm.
But it locks in real nice. Anyway, you feel the handle on that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've liked all the handles I've grabbed a hold of so far. Yeah,
they're all kind of the same.
Yeah.
A little bit of variation in length because of the bow. This bow has a smaller riser in it. But this... this was designed for saddle hunting and spot and stock.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So now I can utilize both nocks on this. Again, I can go with a 53 because I'm only going in half-inch increments.
Mm-hmm.
I could go in one whole inch and go to 54, but I choose to do this. But somebody could order a bow that way. So say we're just going to go to the 52 nock. That would be the inside one there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, so you would string with this one. So basically you just put this down on here. This isn't a very good string either. Now, of course, you could string this the Boy Scout way, but I don't advise doing that to any. But if you're in the woods and you got to do it, you got to
sure.
do it. Unstringing a bow in the woods is easy, but stringing it might be a little bit more arduous, especially if it's high weight, which this is not.
How many what's the weight on that bow?
It's not that heavy. It's 47 at 26.
So it'd be over 50 for me then.
Yeah. Just depends. I gotta test your draw because this
you can't draw
this past 28.
Okay.
It maxes out. Again,
I don't want to break it on you.
Again,
test my draw. I've never actually
55 at 28.
Yeah.
47 at 26.
That'd be perfect for me. 50, 55.
And this one is 47 at 26. at 52. I think the outer one is 53. I didn't write that on there. This stuff just gets crazy. when I do, I mean, the guy buys the boat to put it on there.
Yeah.
So, and this is a stringing knock anyway.
So, yeah, yeah.
But it's functional. That yeah, could but be strung still, up. You right. could take pounds off of it.
Right.
You have to loosen the string up a tad. Mm-hmm. Or just, in this case, if I strung it up.
You'd have your brace height would be taut higher or lower, I guess, technically.
Well, it'll, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, but I'm not sure. I think this guy's split fingered because it looks pretty even.
Yeah.
Probably is. But again, this, and this bow is not completed yet. It doesn't have the sight window in. It's just in sealer. So it's all going to be block sanded out and then the camo put on there and the final matte clear coat put on it. But you see that this is a pretty short bow.
Yeah, it's super compact.
And a great saddle hunting bow.
Yeah.
So this is what Cody's bow is right here. It's almost, that's before I do the takedown system on it. But so that one, it's going to look like this, basically.
Man.
It's got a green riser on it. But his has got a little more weight on it because that's what he wants. But
yeah.
I'm going to do double knocks for him as well to where he can knock on the outside if he wants to lose a little bit of weight.
Mm-hmm.
But you string on the outside, then you got to, you know, you got to string
yeah.
it. You got to do this to string it. Which,
right.
you know, if you do it right,
right.
it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it really... I know guys that do it like this.
Yeah.
I can't do that.
Yeah.
I learned the hard way a long time ago. So, yeah, that's that.
That's awesome looking bow.
So the thing is knowing your draw length and knowing what you can, you know, if you want to go super short, you need to go on what bow is good for you at your draw.
Right.
This, I would say, no more than 28. 28 is max. I mean, when you pull this to 28, it's like this.
My compound's always 28 inch draw, so I'm probably under that
You're
little
27.
Bit. Yeah.
Just basically put that on there.
Oh, yeah.
Just kind of pull that and set it into the groove. And this goes over the end. Like this. And that goes up as high as it'll go. Not sure about the brace height on this string, but anyway, double foot it in and then just commit to it. Sometimes it wants to do that, which makes it a pain in the booty. Okay, yeah, that's good. I think I had this on a longbow. I might have done some goofy stuff with it. And you check it. And on these bows, like, I do a lot of 300, and the top limb is usually negative, meaning it's a little stiffer.
Mm-hmm.
I always set the tiller, and then I'll pull it back. So, you want to draw a nice drawing bow?
That's it, huh?
Yeah. And this bow is 44 at 27.
Okay, so that'll be...
Yeah.
Is this two piece?
Yep.
Oh wow, yeah, that's comfortable.
Yeah. Draw is super nice.
Yeah.
Draw force curve on that bow is crazy.
Yes, it is.
All right, that's gotta go. Watch your end. Yeah, I was gonna say, watch your end.
Oh yeah, from the...
Yeah, it went right off the...
I forgot the arrow was your arrow.
How quiet it is. It's fast too.
Yeah. Your tab completely broke on you now.
Ah.
It came. I was wondering, like, oh, it came out of my hand.
Two shotter. Dad, I'll unwrap it.
That shoots pretty good.
Oh yeah. And that's a low poundage bow. I mean, you're in low 40s.
Oh really?
Yeah. Well, look at the side of it. My arrows are, I got 25 inch draw, they're not very long.
45 pounds at
28. 45.
Thanks for letting me check out your shop, Steve. What you're doing is truly a work of art. If you guys want to check out Bushman Bows, look in the description for the website. Also, follow Bushman Bows on Instagram. If you want to see another video, click up here. But before you leave, subscribe for me.